They have to understand our language, our identity. They have to understand the many, many ceremonies that we do have. I know that our youth council, they're leaders right now. Into the future, we have to be proud of who we are. We have to be proud of our identity, because that's how we're going to survive again.
And my elder in training over here, I tell him he's not in training no more. But he heard me talk a few times already about a governance structure that we do have. And why are we trying to still adapt to a structure that doesn't belong to us? These foreigners that came here just 500 years ago. We're still trying to adapt to their system, and we can't. Maybe we should turn the tables around. Maybe we should get them to adapt to our structure of governance. We're going to be talking about that governance structure tonight. And it's been around for years and years and years and years.
Ngoduwe Wagadazid Anishinabe was a process that came after the development of the Chinook Nagewin, which is the constitution of the Anishinabek Nation. What that meant was that we now had a document in front of us that was essentially a very good start to looking at our lawmaking authority. But at that time, there was still something missing. And what was missing was this notion of the spirit of the people. So the elders went and they did everything in the Anishinaabewan language. And what came out of that was Ngoduwe Wagadazid Anishinaabe. And it's now a very important part of our restoration of jurisdiction process going forward.
Once people begin to understand what's in the Ngoduwe Wagadazid Anishinaabe, they begin to understand how the constitution of the Anishinaabe is formed. The earth, the air, the water, and the fire are the primary gifts of the Creator to the Anishinaabe people. The Anishinaabe believe that these are the primary gifts that must be protected. The seven gifts of the grandfathers describe the ways or the laws that the Anishinaabe people have to live in order to live a good life. But not only that, but for community and family order so that they can live in a good way. The Creator also gave the Anishinaabe the right to exist in this land as a nation of people. And it's important for people to understand that that means sovereignty. Currently, we have First Nations who are directed by Indian Affairs on how they should run their governments in their communities. Under the Anishinaabek Nation government, we'll do things our own way. In other words, we won't have to follow the Indian Act process.
We're in a very critical time, and we know that the Indian Act does nothing but create problems and challenges for our communities. So let's work together. Let's prove to our children that we know what's in their best interest, because at the end of the day, the experts are here in this room. The experts are back in our communities.
Every aspect of our lives is impacted by these outside jurisdictions trying to occupy the field and take over the running of how things should happen in our communities. Bureaucrats in Ottawa or bureaucrats at Queen's Park or the politicians at Queen's Park and the politicians, you know, in Ottawa do not know our communities. They do not know our people. We can't rely on somebody else's so-called solutions when we have the answers.
If we continue doing these circles here, continue talking about our clan structure, our clans and what their functions are, the better we will be to understand our trail in life.
we're starting to see the clan system take a formal place in our government process. We start to see that the various roles and responsibilities of administration, and we start to see the role of the judiciary and what clan may be responsible for those duties. But the key element here is that they're all based on some very ancient laws and some very inherent responsibilities that we all have as Anishinaabe people. And when we're able to take those things and forward them into the modern elements of who we are as a government today, then we can actually say we are a nation based on the sovereignty that we went to the treaty table with.
Under this new arrangement we have with the Government of Canada, we will no longer elect our chief and councils under the Indian Act. Our communities will have the option of enacting our own election laws and be able to determine things for ourselves, such as what will the qualifications be for to serve as a chief, you know, what are their qualifications that we'll set for ourselves to serve as a councillor, how long will those councils serve, and all those sorts of things that right now are set out in the Indian Act. But there are other powers that are going to be recognized in the agreement with Canada, such as language and culture. So it's important to us to be able to think about and institute ways to use more of our own language, to practice more of our own culture and spirituality, for example, in the way we conduct meetings, such as opening our meetings with prayer, having our spiritual ceremonies be part of our meetings. So we'll have the language and culture lawmaking power recognized in the agreement, as well as powers that we need to, and that most governments need, such as the power to implement a law such as the Financial Administration Act. And some of the other lawmaking powers that are recognized in the agreement are citizenship, so our First Nations can determine who the citizens will be of the First Nation.
We have that authority, the right, the responsibility to say who our members are. It's up to us. Even if they've never been recognized legally, doesn't matter. We will have that right to say yes. It's not just for us that we're doing this. We're here for the young people, but we're thinking about the future generations, the generations to come.
And they finally said, it's time for us to take charge and to reinstate our inherent rights to make laws, to run our own communities in our own way. That is, to restore the jurisdictions.
I had no idea about like self-governing and how sufficient that we could potentially be. Like first it seemed a little grim. I didn't think that we could actually get our feet off the ground after everything that happened in history. So now I have a lot of confidence moving forward and being one of the people to initiate self-governing in my community. So
I knew there was a clan system, like a governoral clan system, but I never knew the responsibilities of each and every clan. And now that I know it and we're trying to make that a reality, well, it is a reality, but we're trying to like input it in our lives today, that seems like just an amazing idea. I think we'll go so much further that way.
The government has replaced all of our systems that we already had existing prior to contact. The amount of friction we're getting in our fight to restore our jurisdiction, which is rightfully ours, it's inherent, we've never given it up, that's what aggravates me the most.
And there's no excuse for us to not know these things. It is very, you can't see where you're going unless you know where you've been. And for us to know our histories is very important, and I'm sure that it isn't something that's well known around here. We know that we've come up against opposition and come out ahead before, so there's no reason we can't do it again.
I'm interested in any knowledge or information or skills that will give me the ability to grow as a person and to also then later on maybe have a positive effect on family, community, and nation.
You know, once you inspire someone, that's when you realize how much you have to offer and the gifts you have to offer that you were given. And I keep hearing about this fire within us.
The really important reason why I think we're embarking on a self-government agreement and enacting constitutions are really to take some steps and measures that are going to help turn things around for our communities. And so having our own constitutions is
our people's way of saying, here's what our communities are about, here's the values and the beliefs and the principles that are important to us, here's the lawmaking powers that we're going to say council can exercise on behalf of the people. And so when we build those things like the constitutions and we build our appeal and redress mechanisms, we build them in a way that match our own unique Anishinaabe culture. They're a reflection of our values, our way of doing things, and when we do that, they have more legitimacy in the eyes of our people that they were designed to serve, because they were built by our people and built for our people. So it's important to have a cultural match. When you reflect back on the look and the content of the Anishinaabek Nation Chinooknagewan, you'll see the first thing you're going to see there is the reciting of the Ngudeongazit Anishinaabe, which is what I spoke of earlier, the reflection of our traditional values, our beliefs, our seven grandfather teachings. And that's an example of the cultural match I was talking about, whereby we built a constitution, we built a Anishinaabek Nation Chinooknagewan, and it's completely reflective of who we are as Anishinaabe people. So having our own jurisdiction is really, really important, and that's why we're engaged in negotiations with Canada to get Canada's recognition for our lawmaking powers in the area of governance and education. It really is no more complicated than that. It's taking control of our destiny. It's about enacting our own laws and really putting in place the kinds of things that have been shown to work through the research. It's no more complicated than that.
When is this going to happen? We're doing it today. We are actually asserting, we're exercising those rights, and we're now putting pieces in place that demonstrate, you know, we have been taking our responsibility despite the Indian Act, despite other policies that are being imposed on our people. We are still seeking direction from our elders. We still have our ceremonies intact. The language, even though it's in a meager state right now, we're reclaiming that language, and those very things give us the assurance that we have always practiced our jurisdiction, that we have always upheld the principle of who we are as a sovereign people. It's now just having governments recognize that. It's now just having industry recognize that when they want to develop on our lands. And I think what's happening is governments are now being forced to look at the option and to look at the processes that we're putting in place in our negotiations for education, for self-government. And what people are clearly recognizing is that those laws have already existed. We don't have to make these laws up. We don't have to try to grasp at straws. We go through our protocols, our ceremonies, we speak to our elders, we talk to our knowledge keepers, we get that direction, and we will find that our jurisdiction has always been there in our communities.